It was so much easier to commit crimes in the 70s. Why do you think it was a heyday for serial killers like the Zodiac Killer, John Wayne Gacy, and David Berkowitz? Incidentally, forensic DNA testing first successfully solved the criminal case in 1986. Dr. Alec Jeffries, a British geneticist, used genetic fingerprinting to solve a pair of sexually motivated murders in Leicester, UK. After this breakthrough, other crime scene investigators across the globe started to see similar success with these scientific methods. For aspiring criminals, it was all downhill from there. But that's not going to be you. No, you're a different class of ne'er-do-well. People always told you that crime doesn't pay. Really? Pablo Escobar was spending $2,500 a month on rubber bands to keep the rest of his money together. And forensic DNA testing? No biggie. There are ways around that. You heard stories of criminals filing off or altering their fingerprints to get away with their dastardly deeds, but can you do the same with your DNA? Think your DNA is as unchangeable as your eye color? We regret to inform you that you're dead wrong on that one. And if you're really serious about taking on a criminal career, you better listen close and consider your options. Before we proceed, here's a quick science lesson about what exactly DNA is. If you're a fan of Jurassic Park, the phrase "the building blocks of life" probably jumped to mind, and you wouldn't really be wrong. The actual DNA acronym is short for deoxyribonucleic acid. Its structure is the famous double helix, formed of two chemical strands called nucleotides and held together by four chemical bases: adenine A, thymine T, cytosine C, and guanine G. DNA essentially stores the information for the development of your body. Now that we've gotten that out of the way, let's get back to changing your DNA for fun and profit, particularly of the criminal variety. First, you think, well, I better check and see how people have done this on purpose in the past. So you begin your research, and suddenly, you're seeing the name Josiah Zaner everywhere. Who is this guy calling himself a biohacker? And furthermore, what the heck is a biohacker? That sounds like something straight out of Blade Runner. Well, our morally dubious friend, biohacking is a practical branch of the transhumanism movement. Biohackers are people who practice self-experimentation with the aim of improving their biology through science. You may hear this and start picturing Resident Evil-style supermutations or elaborate cybernetic enhancements like robotic limbs and AI-assisted brains. And while this kind of thing is on the mind of some biohackers, many methods of biohacking are simpler, DIY systems of body and mind improvement. Jack Dorsey, CEO of Twitter, praises the curative powers of drinking salt juice and fasting. Other biohackers heavily moderate their sleeping or exercise habits to achieve desired results. Some dabble in simple cybernetic enhancements like chips and even subcutaneous lights. On the more extreme end of things, you've got Silicon Valley investors interested in young blood transfusions. These are, as the name suggests, older individuals receiving regular blood transfusions from young, healthy donors to preserve their youth and vitality. So I guess vampires are real after all. Anyway, back to Mr. Josiah Zaner, a biohacker who claims to have successfully changed his DNA. You eagerly read into the story, hoping that with his simple method, you'll be bankrolling the Escobar dollars in no time. Who is this man, and what exactly did he do to change his DNA? Zaner is a lifelong devotee of the biohacking movement. The 38-year-old former NASA employee believes science and technology are the best paths to unlocking the true potential of the human body, and as a testament to his beliefs, he uses himself as a guinea pig. While his more recent stunts include injecting his arm with modified CRISPR DNA in hopes of stimulating muscle growth, you bookmark that one for later. Of real interest to you is Zaner's full-body microbiome transplant in 2016. For the record, the microbiome is a term for the ecology of microbes in your body. Josiah Zaner had been plagued by gastrointestinal issues his whole life, and so decided to treat this with a fecal matter transplant. What exactly is a fecal matter transplant, you wonder? While fecal matter transplants are an accepted medical treatment, Josiah Zaner's take on the treatment involved using antibiotics to eliminate his gut bacteria – don't try this at home – and then ingesting samples of his friend's feces to replace said bacteria. Don't try that at home either. However, at least according to Zaner's self-reporting, the treatment did change his life for the better. His homegrown DNA sequencing confirmed that he had indeed changed his gut microbiome. Between oddball treatments like fecal matter transplants and injecting CRISPR DNA, you could become a whole new person. In the words of Zaner himself, "This is the first time in human history that we're no longer stuck with the genes we had at birth." That being said, Zaner kind of lost you at the ingesting his friend's feces part. I mean, you want to start collecting your ill-gotten gains, but not quite that badly. There has to be a non-gross way of changing your DNA, right? The search goes on. While researching more methods of evading forensic DNA detection, you find you're seeing the words gene therapy an awful lot. You also see the story of Brian Madeau, a 44-year-old man from Phoenix, Arizona, who was treated for his enzyme-inhibiting genetic disease with a gene-editing liquid. The disease was costing Brian hundreds of thousands of dollars in treatment costs every single year, without ever really providing him a better quality of life. Thanks to gene editing, his chances of recovery have never been better. Sandy McRae, the CEO of the company responsible for Brian's therapy, explained the process as follows. We cut your DNA, open it up, insert a gene, and stitch it back up. Invisible mending. It becomes part of your DNA and it's there for the rest of your life. Gene editing as a treatment for genetic disease has become increasingly mainstream over the last several years, thanks to advances in science and technology in this area. In late 2017, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration approved Luxturna, a drug capable of altering the patient's DNA. Specifically, Luxturna treats a rare form of hereditary genetic blindness. Much like Josiah Zaner's CRISPR dosages, Luxturna is injected, so it isn't the kind of thing you can obtain without a serious prescription. Scott Gottlieb, who was the FDA chairman at the time, said that he expected the benefits of the new gene therapy treatments to increase exponentially. Much like the criminal enterprise you're hoping to start once you figure out this whole DNA thing, the gene therapy industry has opened up new markets for entrepreneurs. A huge number of medicine and software startups focused around supporting gene therapy have sprung up in the last few years, such as Insilico Medicine in Latvia and Paradigm Diagnostics in Phoenix. Over time, it's possible that gene therapy could become as common as chemo or radiotherapy in treating genetic cancers. Emerging gene editing treatments include Strimvelis, which treats dangerous autoimmune diseases. Kymriah treats leukemia in children by fighting cancer cells. And the aforementioned CRISPR, which stands for Clustered Regularly Interspaced Short Palindromic Repeats, hopes to simply edit disease out of human genomes. Someday, when suffering from previously incurable genetic diseases, you'll be spoiled for your choice with which gene therapy treatment to choose. Sounds good for people suffering from genetic diseases, but not all that useful for avoiding the police. You probably need a diagnosis and much better health insurance to change your DNA through gene therapy. Next option. So you ask yourself, are there any cheaper ways of doing this? What are some of the things that can alter your DNA? After more meticulous research, you find some answers. In 2017, food company Nestle convened a huge group of 550 scientists to research the links between nutrition and epigenetics, or the field of study concerning the links between gene expression and external or biological factors. They found evidence that modifying your diet can, in fact, impact the gene expression of you and your children. Adequate and balanced nutrition can help prevent the presentation of certain genetic diseases, such as cancer or Alzheimer's. This can go both ways, as poor food or drink intake can actively encourage negative gene expression. For example, a study conducted by the scientific journal Alcoholism, Clinical and Experimental Research, found that chronic binge drinking can cause alcohol dependency on a genetic level. So it's best to be mindful of what you put in your body because your genes certainly will. However, epigenetics is a lot more complicated than a simple one-to-one correlation between diet and gene expression. Countless factors can play into this. Amongst them are stress, exercise, and childhood experience. Harvard researchers have found that mice observed under chronic stress experience epigenetic modifications towards stress disorders and mental illnesses like depression and schizophrenia. A similar phenomenon has been recorded in humans. In 2016, a study in Mount Sinai Hospital found that epigenetic stress can be inherited, as the descendants of the Holocaust survivors experienced higher rates of stress disorders than the general population. An epigenetic study from Northwestern University professor Tom McDade found that one's childhood environment can modify genetic expression in adulthood, particularly in terms of developing genetic diseases. He discovered that certain childhood conditions in his sample group, such as being in a low socioeconomic group, prolonged parental abuse, and microbe exposure, could affect the child's future levels of inflammation. This inflammation would in turn be the trigger for the development of other conditions, such as some cancers. This all shows that gene expression is a lot more malleable than you might imagine. However, there's a catch, as always. While epigenetic factors can affect gene expression, they don't cause any permanent structural changes to the DNA itself. In other words, you can eat, drink, and subject yourself to as much stress as you like. Your DNA will still be identifiably yours under any forensic procedure. So it's back to the drawing board again. You're racking your devious criminal mind here, wondering why it's so darn hard to change your DNA. I mean, in your research, you even found that some people manage to fundamentally alter their DNA by accident. Some people get all the luck. People like Chris Long. Chris Long is an IT worker from Nevada who underwent a bone marrow transplant in hopes of treating his nasty case of acute myeloid leukemia. His doctor was an unidentified man from Germany whom Long was extremely close with in a truly unexpected way. How exactly? It's because the DNA present in Chris Long's semen is not his own, it's his donor's. While other samples of DNA taken from Chris, such as cheek swabs and blood samples, still registered as his DNA, his semen only displayed the donor DNA. Why? At this stage, nobody's quite sure. Though if someone like Chris committed a crime with a sexual element, forensic science would not be able to trace the crime back to him, unless of course they were aware of the condition in the first place. This presents a terrifying precedent for future of forensic science now that this is a possibility. However, seeing as you can't volunteer for a bone marrow transplant without suffering from blood or bone cancer, you're not going to have much luck here. DNA is starting to feel like more trouble than it's worth, seeing as it's so hard to change your DNA. Wouldn't it just be easier to get rid of it entirely? Would such a thing even be possible? Well, yes. But it's not something you'd like to experience. One horrific example is the last 83 days of the life of Hisashi Auchi, a 35-year-old Japanese lab tech who worked in the Tokimura nuclear power plant. During a mishap with dangerous quantities of uranium, Hisashi Auchi and some other technicians were exposed to lethal doses of gamma radiation. Unfortunately for Hisashi, he survived the incident, even after taking 17 sieverts of radiation. For context on the significance of this, 8 sieverts is considered a lethal dose. Hisashi experienced quite possibly the largest amount of radiation experienced by a living human being. In an infamous question of scientific ethics, he was kept alive for 83 days while scientists tested the effects of the radiation on his rapidly and horrifically degrading body. Thankfully, he was at least in a medically induced coma until his eventual death. The radiation poisoning Hisashi suffered from was said to be so severe that it completely eliminated his DNA. You probably shouldn't be trying to change your DNA, but nobody's stopping you from changing your mind for the better. Why not check out some of our other videos on genetics, like these gene mutations gave some people superpowers, or when royal inbreeding went horribly wrong. You can trust us, making interesting videos is in our DNA.